My mother used to call me bluish, like black and Jewish.
We identify as kindred.
I identify very strongly with not being gendered.
Straight, white, male.
Taiwanese American woman.
Somebody who likes to read and write.
African American.
Native American.
American Muslim.
Brother.
Tomboy.
Transgender.
Gay.
Spirit.
Latina.
Capoeirista, dancer, singer.
East Coaster.
American Muslim Pakistani.
Gardener.
Parent.
Mom.
We identify as one, we identify as many.
As much as we construct an identity, it's only as much of a thing that we have control over when people agree with that.
I was a cocktail waitress and I worked in Fisherman's Wharf, and Med would place bets on my ethnic background. I would tell them what I was and they would say, no, you are not that. And then I would say, well, yes, I am. I'm a member of the Upper Mattaponi tribe of the Powhatan Nation. They had an assumption about me and it never fit what they thought I was. I think when somebody asks you the question, what are you? You can stop and say, what are you? It's a question that when put back on somebody, then I think it makes them stop and think.
I have no control how others perceive me. I can manipulate my aesthetic to calibrate against the audience, to change how they might perceive me. And so, for example, if I'm talking to somebody who comes from a very particular kind of WASPy background, I can calibrate my aesthetic, the way I speak, the things I talk about, to appear well-cultured to them, like a Renaissance person. I can change languages, I can do a variety of things. There's a cost to doing that. As women of color, as black women, we get small in front of white people, for example, because we know it's going to make them more comfortable, but the cost is that we're making ourselves small. But the way I control it is I am intentional about my actions. I evaluate the choices I'm making and the cost or the benefit of those choices. And ultimately, I think as long as I feel like I am controlling my own narrative, I am being perceived and viewed the way that's important to me, no matter the outcome, and that I get to define myself, then that's where the power or sort of the healthy side of that equation stays with me.
So I don't play basketball at all. It's not as though I didn't play it as a kid, but I know from my experience in high school, people identify me as that black guy who's then gonna, you know, play basketball. So being out on the playground, oh, let's pick him for a team, right? And for me, part of it was like, I'm just not gonna be that. You know, partially because I wasn't all that interested in playing basketball, but I also didn't want to be reduced to a caricature or stereotype.
None of us are one thing in total. We're sort of slices of identity.
Growing up with a Jamaican father, Choctaw, and Southern black mama, I had the opportunity to experience fluidity as a bicultural person.
I am my parents' struggle when they came here from Pakistan. I am my grandparents when they had to go from India to Pakistan, you know, during the partition. I am the Simpsons episodes that I grew up on.
That informed me and gave me a lot of my direction around conversations that happened later on in life when it was explained to me that I am Negroid, when it was explained to me that I am cisgendered female, when it was explained to me that I come from a certain SES, you know, in terms of my family's financial status as I was growing up. And I decided that none of that actually was true.
At some point, you just kind of stop caring what other people think, because in the end, I have to live with myself, and I don't want to pretend to be somebody I'm not, because if I pretend to be somebody I'm not, then there's nobody out there who's going to pretend to be me, and I don't want to miss out on that.